there, and then here at 4 o'clock and 5:30, church service. And it's going to be amazing. It's going to be great, just because we're celebrating. We're celebrating the King of Kings. Amen. All right, hey, let's jump into this, because I want to get real literal late. Matthew chapter 2. And so after the wise men were gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. Get up. Flee to Egypt. Somebody shout Egypt. Flee to Egypt with the child and his mother. And the angel said, stay there until I tell you to return, because Herod is going to search for the child to kill him. I want to preach to you today from the title, Flight into Egypt. Flight into Egypt. Father, we just thank you for your blessing today, God. We thank you for these amazing people that are here today that fought through the weather, fought through life, fought through difficulty, fought through just the holidays so far of so many things going on, so many things happening, but said, listen, I'm seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. I'm putting him first. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, amen. So there's so much in this text right here, just verse 13. I probably could preach a month-long message just on this right here. There's just so much to pull from, so I'm going to try to get some of it, and hopefully it'll minister to you today. But the first thing that I get about this, and I want to thank just one of my professors in college for really helping me kind of, if I was in college, I would say extrapolate from this text, but I'm just in the Ohio Valley, just pull up out of this thing, you know? So the angel shows up and says, listen, I want you to go to Egypt, and I want you to wait. I want you to go to Egypt, and I want you to wait. Now, I really could take some time and talk about Egypt, but you and I could really relate to this text. I really relate to this text because you think of all places to go, Egypt. It would be like living down south in the nice, beautiful weather and the comfortable of the south, and God saying, get up and go to the high valley. That's what it, go to the cold, go to the snow, wake up and there's snow on the ground. And so, but he said, get up and go to Egypt. And there's so much about Egypt. You know, the children of Israel had come up out of Egypt. But like I said, that's kind of not where I'm running today. But what my professor had taught me is that so often when we're reading the Bible is that we will see something transpire in a text, and only a couple scriptures you see, because you'll see later, and I don't have the scripture for you, but I think it's in maybe verse 16 or 17, it says that they left Egypt, that the angel shows up and says, all right, now get up out of Egypt. Now, to us, when we read that, we see just a couple scriptures, and it almost seems like, hey, get up, go to Egypt. And it almost, when we read it sometimes, we look at it like, okay, well, they went to Egypt, they went to Bob Evans, they got some breakfast, and then they went back to where they needed to go. But actuality is that many historians and many theologians and many folks, there's a little dispute about it, but most of them agree that they remained in Egypt anywhere between 8 months to 3 years. It wasn't just, when we read scriptures, it wasn't an hour moment. It wasn't just a day. It wasn't they went down and stayed at a Holiday Inn for a couple days and went back. They're here for, all they got was go to Egypt and wait. Go to Egypt and wait. One of the hardest things to do in our Christian walk is to wait on God. Let me put it this way. One of the hardest things even now within our walk is waiting on God's timing. Even Mary and Martha and Lazarus had been dead 3 days, and homegirl went off on Jesus because she didn't want to wait. If you would have been here, my brother would not have died. He's like, oh, hold on. We never want to wait. Even now we live, I remember, you know, growing up, we had dial-up, and you would wait forever on dial-up, on internet. Now when you call Comcast, the first thing you ask them, you don't ask them price. How fast can I get? Because nobody wants to wait. I'm wondering, and you know me, I like to jump into a text, and that's why I jumped into this text here. And so I'm wondering, you know, Mary and Joseph, who are young, teenagers. The Son of God, she has the Son of God. And an angel comes and says, go to Egypt and wait. That's all. That's all the word they get. Go to Egypt and wait. So if I'm in the text and I go and I'm showing up in Egypt, okay, this ain't too bad. And so if you're there, if theologians are saying that a year, maybe even 3 years, let's say 6 months, where are they staying? They had to find a place. He's got to work. They got to get money. They got to take care of. They got to do. And so I'm wondering, as time is going, as he's there, maybe a month goes by. Mary, did you see that angel anywhere? Because I'm sure waiting on this guy. And then you're wondering, he doesn't say, he says, just go and wait. Well, do we say anything? Like, what do I say? Joseph, what do I say if I'm walking through the marketplace and somebody says, oh, what a beautiful child. Oh, it's the Son of God. Okay. It's waiting. I wonder if Mary and Joseph wonder, what do we do? What do we do? Maybe I would almost think, because it wasn't like every day he's talking to them, every day an angel come down and, oh, hey, hold on. You would almost have to think, maybe, let's say they were there for a year. Let's say 1 year. I'm thinking by month six, yo, God, what's up? Like, what are we doing? Like, what's happening? What? I would say this much, and maybe you're the same way. Hey, you think he forgot about us? Has anyone ever been in a season of waiting and you felt like God forgot about you? Do we just remain hidden? Do we just stay here? I want to take a minute, and I do got a few minutes. I want to take a minute and talk to somebody who's in a waiting season. Who's in a waiting season. I would say one of the top three things that are the toughest in Christianity, if you're new to Christianity, I would say the top, I'm not going to go through all three. Number one is battling your flesh, for sure. Let me give you number two. Number one and number two are intermingled. You're battling your flesh, and then number two is your mind. That's why the Bible says renewing your mind. And number three, maybe it's for me, maybe not for you, but for me, that my hardest thing in Christianity of walking this thing out for, I don't know, as I was 18, 19 when I gave my heart to the Lord, 32 now, so. But number three, one of the hardest things is trusting him when you can't trace him. Is trusting him when you're wondering, where are you, God? Is trusting him when you're wondering, God, have you forgotten me? Is trusting him. Mary and Joseph are in Egypt, and they're wondering, man, we all this thing just rolled up on us. God, are you sure? God, what is going? God, where are you? And no angels popping up. No angels showing up in Egypt. Nothing's happening. God, where are you? It's trusting him when you can't trace him. But I found that when you're in that season of waiting, when you're in that season of trying to trust him when you can't trace him, I found for me personally, and I pray that it's for you too, is that just hold on. God is preparing you for greater things. Hold on, God is preparing you for greater things. And here's the thing that we get all messed up and we try to rush out of the waiting season, because I've been waiting and I'm waiting and waiting and waiting, but God is not, he has you in this waiting season, but God is not preparing the blessing for you. He's preparing you for the blessing. Can I say it again? God is not preparing the blessing for you. He's preparing you for the blessing. God says, I have something for you. I have not forgotten you. His word will not return to void. So if he said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you, when he says the plans I have for you are to prosper you and not to harm you, to give you a future and a hope, then you better count it done that God has a plan for you. God has a purpose for you. But God says, where I'm taking you, what I have for you, what I have designed for you, where you're at right now, you'll mess it up. You'll jack it up. You are not ready for it. So I gotta put a sign on you that you are a work in progress. And so what I gotta do is I gotta get you ready. I gotta work some things out of your heart. I gotta work some stinking thinking out of your mind. I gotta work some stuff out of you until I get you prepared. So I gotta put you in a season of waiting. Oh, you want some scripture for this? Let me bring some scripture to this. You're like, oh, I like it, but bring some word. Okay. Okay, boo. We got you. Abraham loved God. Abraham is like as the world turns a little bit. It is. I mean, he has Ishmael and then Hagar, and he hooked up with her and she worked at the house, and then Sarah was mad. I mean, literally, it's as the world turns. That started there. Soap operas. It was like. And then they're all excited that he got a child. And then Sarah came and said, no, they got to go. And he's like, do I got to tell them? You tell them. No, you tell them. And then he's like, hey, girl, you got to go. She said, what you talking about? I got to go. I got a kid with you. Who's going to pay child support? He said, I don't know. God just told me you got to go. And I'm supposed to listen to her over there. And I don't go, get out. And as they're going, then Sarah turns around, and this is Isaac, and this is the promise, and this is going with the promise. We ain't got time for all that. Oh, okay. Poor Abraham. But now they have Isaac, the promise, right? The thing that they've been believing for, and so everything, great, yeah, we got Isaac. Sarah's finally slow to roll a little bit. Everything's good. He's got a little peace in the house. God shows up and said, hey, Abraham, what up, God? I want you to sacrifice Isaac. I just got rid of one, and now you're telling me to sacrifice Isaac. I don't know if I told you this. God is not preparing the blessing for you. He's preparing you for the blessing. Isaac, I want you to go up to top of Mount Moriah. And I want you to sacrifice your son. Now, Mount Moriah, he's going up. Almost a little bit like, what was Price is Right with that little guy? Do-do-do-do-do-do-do, right? That's just how I think sometimes. Sorry. Y'all too young to know anything about that. But that's what it's kind of like. And he has no idea. Now, y'all know the story because we read the story. Y'all know the story that there's a ram up on the other side. He can't see it, but he don't know that. We know that, but he don't know that. All he knows is he was told to sacrifice his son. But this is where, I didn't know if I told you this point yet. God is not preparing the blessing for you. He's preparing you for the blessing. This is where everything changes in Abraham's life. Because he grabs Isaac. And even Isaac says something, said, yo, I see you got the wood. I see you got the rope. I see you got the flint. I see you got everything for a sacrifice. Yo, what's up, Dad? you know, now I'm a father, you know, it's, you become a father, you become like a parent, the scripture's totally changing your life. You know, I was single, I wouldn't preach it. It's like I'm envisioning myself, you know, I call him JoJo. And it would be like, Dad. Did I sound just like him? Dad. No, it would be the bro. Noah, you laugh. I'm bringing you into this message. He looked at his brother, shake a hand. Bet. And he says, or I would say, JoJo, God's going to provide. But here's where everything changes. The Bible says that as Abraham was making his way up to the mountain, he would stop. And he would worship. Yeah, you'll have to read it when you get home. It said that he would stop. He told everybody else, said, y'all stay here. Me and, he's kind of like little country. He said, me and the lad, we're going up yonder. And it said that he would go so many paces and that he would sacrifice and that he would worship. It would almost be like this. As he begins to go, he would take a couple spaces. Go ahead. And he would lift his hands because he didn't know what was going to happen. Do we have the words to that song? Do we have the words? Do we have it? Can you turn it up just a little bit? And it says, in all my life, you've been faithful. And then I just envision him singing because I like to jump into text. Can we keep going on with it? He doesn't know what's going to happen. He's just worshiping. And then he goes and takes another step. And go ahead.
With every breath that I am able.
And then he would take another step. And then he would say it.
I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God.
All right, let's go back to that beginning portion. And then he kept going because it wasn't just a little old mountain. He had to keep on going. And the boy's just falling behind him. So what's going on? And then he would go and go. Are we there? Will you tell me when we're there and we're ready and we're ready? Boom! Then he would stop and he'd begin to worship. Can you stop it right there? He didn't begin to question God. God, what are you doing? Why are you allowing this? God, what's happening in your life? All he knew is he says, God, all my life you've been faithful. All my life you've been good. All my life you've always brought me through. All my life. And I know you're going to bring me through this. I know you're going to make a way through this. I know you're going to bring me through this. I know this. And you say, how is God preparing him for the blessing? God said, I wanted to see if you can trust me when you can't trace me. I wanted to find out that even when you have tears in your eyes, can you still worship me? I wanted to find out that when I do bring you into this thing, that you're not going to have an attitude like you're all too good. That when you get to the thing I got for you, that you're going to look and say, if it had not been for the Lord who is on my side, he wants to know that when I bring you to the promotion, that you're going to say, it was God. When I bring that healing, it was God. When I bring that breakthrough, it was God. When I bring that pain, it wasn't you. Well, I'm just so smart, and I got this, and I worked hard, and I did this. God says, no, I'm the one that brought favor. I'm the one that had it. And he said, I want to make sure that you don't forget about me, so I'm preparing you for the blessing. If I were just to give you the blessing and didn't prepare you, then I wouldn't see you in church until Christmas and Easter only. But I love you. I got a plan for you. I got a purpose for you. I got destiny for you. I got something in you, and I know you don't like being Egypt. I know you don't like waiting. I know you don't like being stuck dormant in Egypt, but I got a plan for you, and I got to prepare you for it. Anybody can worship when life is wonderful. But he said, Abraham, I want to find out, can you worship knowing that you're going to have to sacrifice your son? He said, I want to know, can you worship knowing that you're going to be laid off after Christmas?
I want to know, can you worship when you get the bad news? Can you worship even when they don't like you? Can you worship even when things go the way that you wanted to go? Can you worship me even when everything else is falling apart? Can you worship me? Do I got any Abrahams in here? Do I got anybody? Oh, go back to the beginning of it. It's going to be my theme music. Oh, yeah, they got theme music today. This will be my theme music while I'm preaching here today. All my life, he's been faithful. If there's anybody in here that he's been faithful, and you've been in Egypt and you've been waiting, jump to your feet, lift your hands towards heaven, and say, all my life. You better say, all my life. You have been faithful. All my life. You've been so good. And with every breath that I'm able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing. 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 Some of you have been stuck in Egypt and you've been waiting and you're wondering, God, what's going on? Why didn't it happen? Why didn't this take place? Why hasn't this happened? Why hasn't this transpired? Why hasn't this? You've been like Mary and Joseph and wondering, God, where? Where's the answer? Where's the situation? Where is this? And God says, I'm preparing you for the blessing. I'm getting you ready. And I know it don't feel good. Oh, I wish I had a little time up in here. I wish I had time because I told you I'd preach all day. Went to Egypt. Egypt is where the children of Israel come up out of. Egypt is also where they talk about in Deuteronomy. He says, all these years I've allowed you to go through what you went through. Oh, read it when you get home. Deuteronomy chapter 8. All these years I've allowed you. What? To test to see what was in your heart. Said I'd allow some things to happen because I'm preparing. Can I go a little bit further in this? Are you sure? As he's going up the mountain and he's worshiping, as he's going up the mountain and he's worshiping, not knowing what's going to happen. He's going to the mountain and he's worshiping. And he gets to the top. He gets to the top and he looks over and there's a ram in the thicket. Look at somebody and just touch them and say, don't stop now. Don't stop now. Don't stop now. Watch Genesis, Melissa, Genesis 22, verse 13. Watch. I'll get out of your hair. Then Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught. Somebody shout caught. It's the little things in Scripture that utterly amaze me. It does not say that he got up there and there was a ram standing over there. It doesn't say that he went over there and there was a ram that someone had over there. Why did the Bible, you and every version you read, NIV, NIV, RSBCT, no matter what version you read, it all says the ram was caught. Why wasn't he just chilling up there? I mean, it is God, right? Or maybe like the ark. Just bring them, you know. It was caught. And some of you can relate to this in Abraham. Because as Abraham was going up one side of the mountain, the ram was going up the other side of the mountain. And every step that he took, that he was walking by faith and not by sight, the blessing was walking up on the other side. Let me say this. For some of you, that it's been a tough season. It's been a rough season. It's been a frustrating season. For some of you that are going up the mountain, some of you have fallen down, but you got back up. And some of you tripped walking up the mountain, but you got back up. And some of you messed up going up the mountain. God, I'm coming, but I messed up. But I'm getting back up. And some of you are going up the mountain, and you're going after God. And you got tripped up in a relationship. And you got tripped up in a circumstance. And you got tripped up with this addiction. And you got tripped up, but here's the thing: most people stay down, but you got back up. You got back up, and you got back. And you said, "Sorry, God. Here I'm coming, God. I'm coming." And you fell down. You fell down. But I'm coming, God. I'm coming, God. Here's the reason why it was caught in the thicket.
because he didn't know if Abraham was going to turn around and say, no, I don't want to do this. Abraham kept going. And the reason it was caught in the thicket, God says, if you keep going, I'll hold your blessing until you get there. God says every good and perfect gift comes from above. And I'm here to talk to somebody that it's been rough and you've tripped up and you've fallen. But I'm here to let you know that as you keep making your way up into the mountain, there's a ram. There's a ram that's in the thicket, and God says, I'm holding, but I need you to get here. I need you to keep going. The blessing's not going to come and come after you. You're coming up here after it. Oh, you got to keep going. God says, you got to keep believing. You've fallen this year. Keep going. Get up and keep going. Don't quit. Don't give up. Don't throw in the towel. Don't stop. God is holding a blessing until you get there. But my job and Impact Church's job is to get you there. We got to get you there. You got to get there. You got to get there. He's got something for you. Back to Matthew chapter 2, please. There were gone, angel of the Lord, said, get up and flee to Egypt with the child. It's Jesus, right? And what gets me every time is that Egypt was holding the King of Kings and didn't even know it. Egypt had the Ancient of Days and didn't know it. They were sitting amongst the world shaker, the history maker, and didn't even know it. It wasn't that they had some huge, the triumphal entry or anything. He was sitting there and they didn't know. And he said, what's that have to do with today's message? It's why I do what I do. I'm wondering what you're sitting on and don't even know it. Let me go maybe a little further. I'm wondering what you're holding and don't even know it. All right, let me take it a little bit further. I'm wondering what's on the inside of you and you don't even know it. Egypt had them and didn't even know it. So, growing up, my mom and them, to be able to have Christmas, would sell Christmas cookies. But they bake Christmas. Mom, I told them in Weirton that it was like over 100 dozen cookies. How many cookies would you do? How many cookies would you bake during Christmas when I was a kid? Did you say 1900 dozen? It was like Cookie Mania. Cookies everywhere. If you get me cookies and I'm kind of like, thank you. It's just because I ate them breakfast, lunch, and dinner from like November on. Like my mom's like, oh, I got cookies. I'm like, oh, great, Mom. And I'm 32 years old, huh? What'd you say? I do love cookies. But there's certain ones I just can't eat anymore. Just the smell. Even though they're great cookies. But when you're overloaded with cookies, they're in the cars, living room. I mean, people were counting sheep. I was counting lady locks. You like that? But what I always found amazing is that once I turned 16, I would have to deliver the cookies to people. And people, oh, just by the presentation of it.
oh, these look amazing. They didn't even jump in to start eating them, which they're really good. But, oh my goodness, these look amazing. Tell your mom. Just the presentation of it. And I would always, always just giggle within myself. And I would think, if they only knew what it looked like back home. Flour everywhere, sugar here, vanilla, cinnamon. I mean, how many different types of cookies? There was a whole list. I don't want to get into cookie mania on service today. But there was just so many different, just so many different cookies. But I was always amazed that, like, people just had no idea that what it took to get these cookies, right? In Psalms 139, verses 13 down, he says, "You made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb." I love this. "Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in the utter seclusion. As I was woven together in the dark of the womb, you saw me before I was born." This right here is good stuff right here. "Every day of my life was recorded in your book, and every moment was laid out before a single day had passed." Man, that's so good. Can you help me? Take this. Go with that one first. Yeah, come on over there so I can see him. So what he's saying here, he said, "I formed you. I fashioned you." Listen to me, young folks. I don't care what the world tries to tell you. Hello? Listen to me, young folks. I don't care what the world tries to tell you. He formed you and he fashioned you. He knew you in your mama's womb. And he said, "This is the way we're going to go." And you might say, but then why this and why that? Because the enemy corrupts. And what God said here, this is straight cold right here. I think that's what the kids say. I don't know. "Every day of my life was recorded. Every moment was laid out." Whoa, every day, before a day had passed. So he knew what I was going to go through. He knew what I was going to face. But if he knew what I was going to face, then why didn't he do something? He did. Because it says here, "I formed you." Just like the cookies. Let me see. God said, "I see what they're going to go through in 1980, and they're going to need a little courage. They're going to need a little courage. So before you are formed," he said, I'm going to put some courage in them. And then he says, "I know what they're going to battle." He said, "I know what you're going to battle in 2022. He said, "So I'm going to put love in them. I'm going to put love in them and put a little love right there." Yeah. And then he says, I know that relationship is going to tear them up. I know that relationship is going to tear them up. And they're going to need to know about mercy and grace. So I'm going to take a little mercy. I'm going to take a little mercy and grace. I'm going to put down inside of them. Yeah. And then they're going to need, right here. Yeah. Yeah. Cinnamon. They're going to need a little spunk. He must have dumped the whole load on you, baby. Yeah. He said, they're going to need this. They're going to need that. But here's the problem. Here's the problem.
It said that they stayed in Egypt, right? They stayed in Egypt. Who had them in Egypt? They didn't go to Egypt because they wanted to go to Egypt. Herod. Why? Wanted to kill them. Herod is a betrayal of the enemy. John chapter 10, verse 10, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So God's saying, I gave you everything that you needed to get through, but the enemy has allowed it to stay dormant in your life. The enemy doesn't want you to know what you have down inside of you. What do you mean what's down inside of you? You're a history maker. I had one of our professors in our school used to tell us that there some of the greatest books will never be written because people didn't know they had a book down inside of them. Some of the greatest songs will never be sung because somebody didn't know they had a song down inside of them. Some of the greatest things will happen, but they didn't know what they had down inside of them. And so the enemy wants you to stay dormant, stay like this. Because if I tried to just get flour by... Yeah, flour by itself, right? I'm ending with this. Stand to your feet. Stay right there. So, going to Walmart, trying to get some things done, and I run into somebody. It's always at Walmart. Running into Walmart, and so I never said a word about them not going to church. And I never say a word to anybody about ever going to church. You don't come to church, don't come to church. They brought it up. They opened the door. I was like, hey, how you doing? All good, good. Hey, okay, there's a reason why we haven't been coming to church. Well, Merry Christmas. And so I was like, oh, yeah, what's happening? And it's just much. I said, oh, interesting. I said, what do you mean by much? For instance, that guy. Okay, what guy? There's in the middle of worship, there's this guy. He's a stocky guy. And he's just waving his hands at all. Oh! It took me a minute. I'm like, oh, God. I was like, oh. He's like, boo. I'm like, Butch? Like, is that his name? I'm like, this guy, and he just really loves the Lord. Yeah, yeah, loud. I'm like, it's preaching time for me. I said, let me tell you something. I said, what you see as loud and obnoxious, and what you see as, you're used to. And now that I'm thinking about it, I should have said, well, you're just used to staying dormant in Egypt. And I said, let me tell you, so while we're here, while you took my time, I said, let me tell you something about my man. We call him Butchie. Let me tell you something about Butchie. Walk with me, Butchie. What? Now, it wasn't here, but let's go here just for the visual effect of it, so everybody can feel the visual. Right here, I would think. Right? Right. Yeah, I feel that right there. Sit on down right there. Butchie showed up for the first time ever at our Christmas Eve service. I can't tell you what year it was. It was a while. He came to service. Do what you did. Do what you did. Just like that. He sat the whole Christmas. You slide. No. I couldn't see you there. Yeah, right. Yeah, right there. There, go ahead. Make sure everybody can see you. I don't think, grinned at me. He folded his hands the whole service. And did say, I walked over, we knew Jill. Jill introduced me. How you doing?
he sat there. I don't think he liked me. And then never came back. And I thought, man, I see something in that cat. I see something. I know he don't like me, but I see something in him. And then I think a few weeks, it was a while before, I think Jill told him, either go or you're grounded. Jill, did you put him in the headlock and bring him back? Oh, wow. Oh, he said to go back? He said, let's try it again. No, I got the real meaning of it. Let's try it again, because he didn't like it the first time. He sat there. Listen, and this is why I tell the people in Walmart. You come to Impact Church? You wonder why it's loud? Impact Church is not going to allow, which it's not. It's just our vision. It's our heartbeat. We are not going to allow you to stay dormant in Egypt. We see greatness. We met you in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And ever since, my wife said, there is something about that young lady. That's why she came and talked to you at the wedding. She said, I got to get her number. She said, and we were on the beach. I was trying to get Dan. And she said, hey, find out more about her. Find out more. Just call her. I said, why? She says, there's something in her. No one's ever told her. There's something in her. She said, we got to. I know you're scared. Hold, we'll trade.
I'm fine.
No, you're not.
I'm fine.
Let go. To come by. Mm-hmm. And even though she was scared it was going to get messy. And ministry gets messy. And the stuff that you have, it might get a little messy. Amen. But we're not going to allow you. And it gets loud, not just get loud, but that's what happens when you see greatness. You hear me, Bill? When you see something down inside of somebody, we're not going to allow it. The enemy kept Mary and Joseph in Egypt. Dormant, right? And kept them in Egypt. And the enemy's been keeping you in Egypt. And you don't even know that there's greatness down inside of you. You don't even know that what he placed down inside of you. He said, well, my life just has turned so terrible. Says, the enemy has fed you lies. God said, when I formed you and fashioned you, I put something down inside of you, but no one's ever pulled it out. No one's ever stirred it. That's why Timothy says in the gospel in 2 Timothy, stir up the gift. Stir up the gift. I'm a stirrer. And if you don't like stirring, then maybe Impact, find place at that, because we're not going to allow you to stay in Egypt. Butchie, that's how Butchie was, and I seen something in him. And I kept stirring, and I kept stirring, and I kept stirring, and I kept stirring. And the one who wouldn't even budge in service, he never lifted his hands when he first came to service. All of a sudden, one day I see it, I kept stirring it, I kept stirring it. And then one day he's like this. I said, I was telling these people, I said, that what you see now, that wasn't how it started. I said, you're missing what Impact's about. You're allowing these other things to blind you, what God's trying to do in your life and what God's trying to do in your heart. I said, God has put something amazing in you, and he's trying to say, go find some. It don't have to be me. It doesn't have to be Impact Church. It doesn't have, but find you a place. Find you a preacher. Find you a worship team. Find you a worship leader. Find you somebody around that's going to stir up the gift that's down. I'll even go this far. Luke chapter 1, verse 41, so maybe. At the sound of Mary's greeting, Elizabeth's child leaped within her, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Listen, get around people that believe that there is something great down on the inside of you, and that's why it's so important to get in church, because when you get around church, something begins to stir, something begins to leap, something begins to go. I get excited when I see you come walking in church. Something leaps in me, and something leaps in you.
You'll hear it from him, and I'm done. You'll hear it from him.
I could have preached to you. I could have. I almost did. Theo Yanni's. Theo Yanni's, where I met John. Chrissy went to church. He didn't.
Gospel truth. Gospel truth. Tell me I'm not telling the gospel truth.
True.
Tell this is the truth. Hey, do you think you can sing a Christian song for us? You said yeah, and I think just because you were kind of like you're in front of the preacher. I gave him my number. Tell this the truth. We text. And you know what he texts me? Hey, preacher.
Yeah?
I don't know any Christian songs. You don't. Do you know, like, none? I said, what about if I send you one? It started with, right? He didn't know a song. Now he knows hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, right? And hundreds and hundreds. Why? Stirring. Stirring.
We're in the house of the Lord. This got to be gospel.
The moment you came in, because Butchie's preached here, did you ever, ever see yourself preaching?
No.
Here's the thing. God put it down inside of him, but it had lied dormant in Egypt. And the enemy said, our man, and God said, I got to get you in a house. I got to get you in a place. That'll stir it up down inside of you. Lift your hands towards heaven. Father, I pray today for each person within the sound of my voice, God. I thank you. And Lord, I thank you for the people here today, Lord, that you have placed something so amazing down inside of. Lord, despite what the enemy, maybe what the enemy has sent people to tell them, you'll never be this, or you'll never amount to this, or you'll never be able to accomplish this, or you'll never be able. We cancel that today, God. We cancel that right now in the name of Jesus, and we ask, God, that the thing that you have placed down inside of them, that you formed and fashioned down inside of them, God, that it would begin to stir today. That it would begin to stir down inside. And those who've been waiting in Egypt and wondering, God, have you forgotten me? God, have you left me? And Lord, I pray that I can be a voice to let them know, listen, hold on. He's preparing you for what he has for you. And he has the best is yet to come in your life. Father, let strength and mercy come today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Hey, listen. Have a wonderful week. And don't forget the app. And don't forget, invite somebody. Christmas Eve service this coming. It's upon us, y'all. It's upon us.